What do you do when you're overwhelmed? Anybody been overwhelmed this past week? Yeah, okay. Anybody been overwhelmed who wasn't here last week? We're going to give you, okay, yeah. We're going to give you a crash course on the first part of the sermon because we all come to those places. If you're not there yet, you will be there. We all come to places where we face things that are just overwhelming us. So we're talking about a story from 2 Chronicles 20. It's about a king named Jehoshaphat, and he's faced with an invasion of three nations coming against his little nation, and he is overwhelmed. He's overwhelmed. What do you do? What do you do when the odds are against you and it looks like there's no way through, there's no way under, there's no way over, there's no way around? Anybody remember the old song? It's a folk song. Peter, Paul, and Mary used to sing it. I dated myself just there. Rock my soul in the bosom of Abraham. Rock my soul. Remember that one? So high you can't get over it. So low you can't get under. Well, that's the love of God. But we're talking about obstacles. That's a different song. So what do you do when you're overwhelmed? The first thing we said was turn to God for help. Turn to God for help. That's what we sang about today. That's what Alex sang about. You turn to God for help. First, number one, God's not your last resort. He's your first choice. Number two, as you turn to God, focus on God. Learn to focus your mind on God for the help that you need, not the problem. Because a lot of times when we pray endlessly about the problem. Oh, God, you know, this situation, and it's so bad, and I don't know what I'm going to do. And we just go on, and God's like, okay, yeah. But I know what to do, so when are you going to get to the part where you focus on me and my ability? You focus on God and not the problem. And then the third thing is to admit that you're powerless. That's why I love Celebrate Recovery, because the principles that it's built on start always, always, always. Number one, step one is I realize and admit that I'm powerless over whatever it is, the addiction, the habit, the problem, the situation. That's a good place for all of us to have inside of our hearts. How many of you, since the day that you were baptized, those of you that are Christians, believers, since the day that you've been baptized to this day, have never fallen and never sinned? Anybody want to raise your hand? You've just had this upward track, and your life is flawless, right? Anybody? You see, we fall, we fail, we sin, we make mistakes, and God is always saying to you, the way to get back up is to start with step one. Admit that you're powerless. Admit that you need help, right? You don't like fall and then like, okay, I'm going to go back right where I left off. No, you go back to step one. You reach out your hand and say, God, I can't do it. Help me up. And God says, okay, I'll help you up. So what happens if you take the first three of these five steps? If you turn to God, you focus on him and not the problem, then you admit that you are powerless. How does God respond? Well, we talked about that last week as well. And that's our key verse today, is the kind of one of the verses we left off with last week. This is the prophet that comes to the king and to all the people and the soldiers. And this is what he says. Your majesty and all you people of Judah and Jerusalem, the Lord says that you must not be discouraged or be afraid to face this large army. The battle depends on... Let's read this whole thing. It's up there. If you can't see it, borrow someone's glasses, all right? Or turn to 2 Chronicles 20 in your version. I don't care if you read a different version, but let's read it together. Your majesty and all you people of Judah and Jerusalem, the Lord says that you must not be discouraged or be afraid to face this large army. The battle depends on God, not on you. Get it? All right. God's response is, the battle's mine, not yours. The reason why a lot of us are tired a lot of the time, is because we're trying to fight battles that belong to God. We don't have the energy or knowledge or power to do what God can do. But we act like we're God because we think that we have to be in control. We have to solve every problem. You know the saying, we've said this before, And it's not I didn't originate this, but I think it was built into my DNA like it's built in to a lot of yours. If it's to be, it's up to me. You ever said that? Or some form of it? If it's to be, it's up to me. And so you're frantically trying to make something happen. The problem is you're trying to fight God's battle. God alone is God. And guess what? You are not God. In case anybody hadn't figured that out yet. We inevitably fail and we come back to God and we say, oh God, I'm so sorry. Oh God, I've really let you down this time. And God says, you didn't let me down. You weren't holding me up in the first place. You ever think about that? We let God, well, we don't let God down. God's God. We're not holding him up. He says, it's my battle, and you're trying to do it, and that's why you're tired. That's why you don't have any energy. But all of that's just the beginning. Now we have to look at the strategy of the battle. And you can read this entire story in 2 Chronicles 20. It's a great story in the Bible. We want to look at the strategy for the battle, and I guarantee you're not going to see very many armies using this strategy for winning a battle. So this is what it says in verse 17. You will not have to fight this battle. Just take up your positions and wait. You will see the Lord give you victory. People of Judah and Jerusalem, do not hesitate or be afraid. Go out to battle and the Lord will be with you. He says you don't need to fight. Really? And then he says you don't even need to move. Just take up your positions. Sometimes it takes more courage to do nothing than to do something. We want to do something. Isn't there something I can do? God says, no. Be quiet and just wait. If you're standing there and three enemy nations are coming on against you with all their battle equipment and all their armor and all their swords, and God says, I don't want you to run. I don't want you to resist. I just want you to stand there. What does it mean when God says, I want you to stand still? Well, it's really an attitude of quiet confidence in God. That's what it means. God says, I got it covered. I'm going to take care of you. And so he says, you don't have to do anything. I want you just to stand there. When you stand there in quiet confidence, you show God that you believe in him. He wants you to stand still, and he wants you to face it. He doesn't want us to run away, because if we run, we're going to end up facing the problem again, right? You run away from your problems, they're going to come up again. Is that true? Anybody experience that? You try to get away from something, somewhere along the line, it comes back to you. It gets there faster. It's waiting there for you, right? God says, I want you to stand still. He wants to teach you and me that he is sufficient in everything. He is sufficient in everything. I think of all the stuff we have to learn in our lives, for most of us, it takes all of our lives to learn this one thing. God is sufficient for everything. For everything. So he says, this is my battle. You don't need to fight and you don't need to move. And then he says, you don't need to worry. Twice in this passage, in verse 15 and verse 17, he says, don't be discouraged, don't be afraid. He repeats it. Why does God repeat things? We don't get it. He wants us to get it, that's why. It isn't just for literary emphasis, it's because we don't get it. And it's something that we probably aren't going to get unless he says it again and again. So he repeats that we're not to be discouraged, not to be afraid. He says, don't worry, because God never loses a battle that he has chosen to fight. Did you think about that? If God says it's my battle, you think God's going to lose? Does God lose battles? Maybe you've heard of this poem. The world had a hopeful beginning, but this is the great controversy in four lines. The world had a hopeful beginning, but we spoiled it all by sinning. Now we trust that the story will end to God's glory, but right now the other side's winning. But guess what? The story's not over. I've read the end of the story. Anybody here read the end of the story? You can find it in Revelation. You know what the end of the story says? We win. God wins, and those who are part of his family, we win. 2 Chronicles 20:20, this isn't, I don't think this is in your notes, but this is the verse in the Bible where you can get 20/20 vision, perfect vision. You can see clearly as God intends for you to see. And don't break out into singing, Mike, wherever you are. I can see too. This is what it says. Put your faith in God and you'll be able to stand firm. Have faith in His promise, in His prophets, and you'll succeed. Two things. Put your faith in God and you'll be able to stand firm. The two things that everybody wants in their life are stability and success. And some people say, well, I don't care about the stability. I just want to have, I want to have adventure. But you want enough stability so you survive, right? Sure you do. We want stability and we want success. Put your faith in God and you will have stability. You will be able to stand firm. That's where our stability, that's where our anchor is. It's in God. Put your faith, your trust in God. And then it says, have faith in His prophets and you'll succeed. What are His prophets? Who are His prophets? Well, here you go. Put your trust in God, who you know by faith. You've given your life to Him. But then read His word. Read what God says through His prophets, through His apostles. Listen to what God brings to you through the mouthpieces that He sets in your life. Have faith in His prophets and you will succeed. You will succeed. 2020 vision. 2 Chronicles 2020. That's an easy one to remember, right? So now step four. Thank God in advance. Thank God in advance. This is what it says in verse 21. The king ordered some musicians to put on the robes they wore on sacred occasions and to march ahead of the army, singing, "Praise the Lord, His love is eternal." Put on the choir robes. You're not supposed to put these things on unless you're going to church. They're going to battle. They're going to get blood. They're going to get dirt. They're going to have all kinds of things on them. King said, no, put on your choir robes and you're going to be in the front singing, "Praise the Lord, His love is eternal." So I want you to picture it. This army, the army of Judah, is outnumbered at least 3-1 as they go into battle. And instead of the infantry on the front line, who do they have? They have the praise team. They have the music team. They have the singers. Okay. You say that. Have you ever been in battle where they're shooting at you and someone's going to kill you? You're on the front line and the only thing you have is your voice or your guitar. How many people are you going to take out with that guitar? Not too many, we think. The army of Jehoshaphat must have a great deal of confidence in their king because there aren't very many musicians who are really good fighters. Now, I know there's some exceptions in North Hills, I know. But the fact is, he puts the musicians on the front line. It seems like a recipe for instant disaster. And then he says, here's what you're going to sing. Praise the Lord, His love is eternal. And another version says, thank God, His mercy endures forever. They were to thank God in advance for the victory. They were to start singing before anything else happened, before they even took a step, before they engaged at all, they started singing. When are you going to start thanking God for the miracles in your life? You know, the thing or the things that you've always wanted to happen, the prayer you've been praying, the dream you've had, when are you going to start thanking God for doing it before it happens? See, when you thank God for something after it's happened, that's called gratitude. When you thank God for something before it happens, that's called faith. The highest form of faith is to thank God in advance before you even get the answer. Before you get the answer. A lot of times when we pray, we're really bargaining with God, aren't we? We're trying to convince Him or influence Him or wear Him out. That's how our kids do us. You know, daddy, daddy, daddy. Mommy, mommy, mommy. Daddy, daddy, mommy, mommy. My dog does that. She scratches on my leg. She wants a piece of food that I'm eating, you know. Scratches on my leg. Get away. Go on. She scratches on it. She doesn't care. She comes back 20 times until I give her something. And we think we have to wear God out. And I know Jesus told some stories about, you know, the woman who goes to the judge and she keeps banging on his door in the middle of the night, wearing the judge out. We don't have to wear God out. We don't have to do that. But when we pray, we think we do. Sometimes we beg or plead. We even try to bribe God. You know, if you do this, Lord, I will serve you forever. the foxhole prayer. You know about that, Bucky. Did you ever pray that prayer, Bucky? Did you ever pray that prayer? And what happened when you got out of the foxhole? What happened when you got out of the foxhole and everything was okay? You're happy? Did you serve God at that point? Yeah, he served you. It took a while. It took a while. Yeah. If you help me, Lord, I'll go back to church, or I'll start paying tithe, or I'm going to give up some bad habit. I'll serve you. God already knows what you need. God already knows what you want. The Bible says, in fact, Jesus is the one who said it, that God is more willing to give you good gifts than a father is willing to give his children good food. He says, if a child comes to a father and he says, I'm hungry, Daddy, does the father go get a snake and feed his son with it? No, he doesn't do that. He finds good food, finds a good piece of fish. You know, in Jesus' day, they had a lot of fish. Or a good piece of pita bread. He says, here's something good for you. God is more interested in giving us good things, good gifts, than a father is wanting to give his children good things. God wants to answer our prayers, so we need to learn to pray for what we need and thank him in advance. Because while you're praying, while you're working on your prayer and your request, you know what God's doing? He's not working on your request. See, God can instantly answer your prayer. He isn't working on anything. He's working on you. That's what he's working on. He's building your faith. He's building your quiet confidence. He's building your trust, your patience in him. God's not a vending machine where you put in a buck and you get out a bag of Cheetos or what's the peanut caramel bar? Payday. Those things, maybe they quench your appetite for a little bit, but really, most of the stuff you find in vending machines are not that good for you. And the truth is if God were a vending machine, if he did that, he would be giving us stuff that isn't good for us all the time, because we pray for things that he knows are not going to be in our best interest. He doesn't mind if we pray for him. He just wants us to help work through the process so that we get down to what the real needs are. What is it that's driving that? What is it that is pushing you into that felt need? God knows what you need. He knows what will make you happy more than you do. And he knows that what you need is often not what you want, and vice versa. So when you pray, wait on God. Just like he tells the whole army, you got to wait, stand still, wait on God, and start thanking him for the answers. You say, I thank you that the answer is already on its way, Lord. That is the highest form of faith, thanking God in advance. In verse 22, it says, when they began to sing, the Lord threw the invading armies into a panic. When they began to sing. I want you to focus on that. The singing part. Because we're not... I don't know about Jehoshaphat. I don't know about, you know, the veil of Jehoshaphat and the armies and all that. I've never been in the military. I've never really faced a real battle. Some of you have. You've been in horrific firefights and difficult situations. But I've certainly faced the battles of the enemy that are overwhelming to me. Spiritual battles, emotional battles, intellectual battles, trying to sort out whether or not my faith is even valid or well-grounded. What do you do? He says, when they began to sing, the Lord threw the invading armies into a panic. Do you know what singing does for you? Anybody? I've had a sense of this, and I've read a few things over the years, but in preparing for this message, I really became aware of some very specific things about singing. There was an interview a couple of years ago, I think it was in 2013, on National Public Radio. And they interviewed a psychologist by the name of Daniel Levitan, and then a lady who had also written a book about singing. And this psychologist talks about studies that have been done that tell us how singing affects your brain. He actually wrote a book. It's called Your Brain on Music. Get it and read it. It'll be worth your read. So one of the things that it does is when you sing, it helps release dopamine in your brain. You know what dopamine is, right? That's the feel-good hormone. Makes you feel good. You sing in the shower, whether you carry a note or not. Singing in the shower, you got the shower flowing, you're feeling good. It isn't just the water on your body, it's what's going on inside of that brain chemistry. Do you know that also singing helps depress cortisol? Cortisol is something that is produced in your bloodstream when you get anxious, when you're afraid. It wears you down. It's something that's put into our bodies for this flight or fight response, you know, when we're in danger. But the problem is we live our lives, especially in Southern California, in a constant state of anxiety. If you don't believe me, just check yourself the next time you get on the freeway, which is going to be in a few minutes, you know. Check yourself. Be aware of your heart rate and your respiration. When people cut in front of you, when the lights in front of you come to a sudden stop, you know, we're in this constant state of anxiety. Singing helps depress the cortisol, which produces anxiety in our lives. Then it also helps release oxytocin. Oxytocin is known as the intimacy hormone. It's a hormone that helps women in childbirth, but it also is involved in marital relations, if you get my drift. You know, we have a mixed audience here today. It's the intimacy hormone. It makes you feel closer. It bonds you with another person. When you're singing with other people, I'm not talking about singing by yourself in the shower here. I'm talking about singing with people, like in church. That hormone is released. It brings about a sense of connection, of community, of intimacy. Is there anything that's better to bond a church family together than singing praises to God? Singing in a small group, you have to pay attention to what the others are singing, right? I heard in this interview they did with Daniel Levitin, somebody called in while they were doing the interview, and they talked about one of the great choirs they'd been a part of, and they had this wonderful leader. And he organized the choir not in, you know, sopranos and altos and tenors and baritones. He didn't, you know, like usually you put your sections like that. He created mini quartets for his whole choir. So in every group, there was a soprano, an alto, a tenor, and a baritone. And so that forced each one of the people to listen to the other people. That's a great thing, isn't it? It gets you outside of your own head. It gets you outside of your own feelings so that you can harmonize or blend. Studies show that singing has given evidence when people sing together, it has an effect on their heartbeat. It regulates their heartbeat. And some have suggested that it actually begins to synchronize the heartbeats of the people singing together. That's pretty awesome. That's why I love to sing. I love to sing. There's nothing wrong with feeling good. That's the dopamine. That's why people have addictions, because they do these things and it makes them feel good. I had a chaplain tell me one time when I was learning about stop smoking clinics. I wasn't smoking. I mean, I was helping people stop smoking. But he said, people don't smoke for no reason. They have a reason to get something out of it. And I never thought of that. I thought it was just a disgusting habit, you know. He said, no, they're getting something out of it. It's producing the bad habits that people have, the addictions that people have, produces dopamine. They get a good feeling out of it. The problem is the addiction takes them down a road that's going to be self-destructive. They get caught up in these destructive patterns of alcoholism or drug addiction or illicit sex or workaholism, and the list is a mile long. Singing together, though, doesn't have a bad outcome unless you get into a fight over how the song goes or something. When you sing together songs of praise, it helps release these endorphins in a way that will lift your spirits, depress your anxiety, connect you with others, and give you a hopeful outlook. Now, isn't that a good reason to sing? So when you come to church, and we are up here, I'm either at the keyboard or someone, or Chris or Mike says, let's stand and sing. You go, I don't feel like it. I don't want to. My life, I've had a terrible week. I don't feel like singing. It's a miracle I'm even here today. I'll bet none of you have ever felt that way when you come to church. Some of you have felt that way and you stayed home. I know. Well, of course you don't feel like it. You're depressed. You're defeated. The point is, stand up and sing. And you'll feel like it, because when you sing, it starts doing something to you, to your insides. Stand up and sing. Singing helps you out of your depression. It helps change your feelings, helps you get back into the community. We're all part of something bigger than ourselves here at North Hills. Singing together reminds us of that fact. So now we're going to do that. I want you to stand up, and we're going to sing. We're going to sing. This is a song that most of you know, so there's no words. Don't look for the words. Use your mind. Go back into that, you know, whatever that place is in your brain that calls up old words. That's good for you. And we're going to sing the doxology, right? You know that one? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Come on, sing it. Praise him, all creatures here below. You have to take in the air. That expands your chest cavity. It gets your circulation going. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise him. Sing that with me. Praise him. Sing it again. Praise him. Praise him. His love endures forever. Okay, answer me. Praise him. All right. Praise him. Everybody. His love endures forever. Sing it again. Praise him. Praise him. Come on. Praise him. His mercy never ends. You can sing that, can't you? His mercy never ends. Come on, let's do the first one. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. His love endures forever. You're getting it. Praise him. Praise him. His mercy never ends. His mercy never ends. So we praise him. We praise him. Because his love, endures forever. Yes, we praise him. We praise him. Because his mercy never ends. Now you can give yourself a hand. That's good. Sit down. All right. Wasn't that fun? See, it got you. It woke you up. Now you're not going to be bored for the rest of the sermon. All right. We're going to get, we're going to end here real soon. The last thing is to find the blessing, to find the blessing in the bad. When you look at the results that have happened and when you let God fight your battles, two things happen. One of the things that happens is you get blessed beyond measure. You get blessed more than you could handle at all. In fact, it's so much that you want to share with other people. It's just too much. Here's the verses in 2 Chronicles 20. When the Judean army reached a tower that was in the desert, they looked toward the enemy and saw they were all lying on the ground dead. Their singing got them confused, and they killed each other. You think the devil loves to hear us sing praises to God? No, he hates it. It chases him out of the room. And if you're holding on to the devil here, we're going to sing more so it chases him out of your heart, too. It says, not one had escaped. Jehoshaphat and his troops moved in to take the loot, and they found many cattle, supplies, clothing, and other valuable objects. They spent 3 days gathering the loot, but there was so much they could not take everything. God wants you to live not in the valley of the battle, not in the valley where the battle takes place. He wants you to live in the valley of blessing, in the valley of blessing. That's what, there's a Hebrew word for it, baraka. Baraka means blessing. He doesn't want you and I to go through life fighting battle after battle after battle, trying to fight it on our own, getting worn out. He wants us to live in the valley of blessing. That's why we have to let God fight for us. The valley of blessing. And when God blesses you, you know what you get to do? You get to share it. There's another song. Jesus' love is bubbling over. Jesus' love is in my soul. Okay, that's enough. But, you know, God blesses us more than we can handle, so it spills out. If God has blessed you, when you've had an experience in your life, where you've seen God work, and you're just filled to the brim with joy and with goodness, doesn't it have an effect on your relationships with other people? Until you come across that person that goes like, so? But don't let that get you down. God's blessing is still there. He wants you to live in the valley of blessing. You can't carry it all, just like Jehoshaphat and his army. So it says in verses 27 and 28, Jehoshaphat led his troops back to Jerusalem in triumph because the Lord had defeated their enemies. When they reached the city, they marched to the temple to the music of harps and trumpets. One version says Jehoshaphat led his troops back to Jerusalem where they joyfully celebrated the great victory God had given to them. They didn't earn it. They didn't work for it. They didn't buy it. They didn't fight for it. They didn't resist for it. They just got it given to them. They got it given to them. It was all by God's grace. See, that's how you get to heaven, right? You get to heaven by God's grace, not by working for it. You and I are never going to be good enough to get to heaven. I'm not, for sure. I'm a mess. I'll just tell you right now. If you get to know me, if you don't know me, you get to know me, and then you go home one day and you go, boy, Pastor Terry, he's a mess. I'm just telling you ahead of time, so it's not a surprise. God gives us a gift. He brings us into heaven in spite of ourselves. It's by grace. So we've got to say to Jesus, Jesus, I know there's no way I'm going to make it unless you bring me here. I have to trust in your grace. It's the only way I'm going to make it there. And so you get more blessings. You get more blessings. And people are going to see in your life how God is blessing you as you learn to trust him. It isn't that everything's going to come out the way you think it should or the way that you wished it would in the beginning. But if you trust in God, if you come to him and wait on him in quiet confidence, if you let God fight the battle for you, you're going to learn to follow his lead. You're going to listen. You're going to hear his voice tell you what to do in the situation you're in. When you let God fight your battle, it's a witness to everyone around you. It's a testimony, even to your enemies. Verses 29 and 30 say, every nation that heard how the Lord had defeated Israel's enemies was terrified. So Jehoshaphat ruled in peace, and God gave him security on every side. So that's what God wants for us in our lives. Is there anybody here that wants peace and security for the rest of your life? I do. We just have to do it God's way. That's all. God loves to demonstrate his power in very ordinary, flawed people like you and me. He doesn't need special people. He just needs people. Just needs you and me. People who learn to trust him completely. I don't know what's overwhelming you today. I have a guess that for a lot of you, there's something overwhelming. Maybe you're a single parent. You're trying to hold it all together. Anybody who's been a parent at all knows how hard that can be. And if you're on your own, it's just at times it seems impossible. So stop trying to do it on your own. Turn to God. Let him fight for you. Maybe you're an immigrant. And you're trying to make it in this new culture, in this new country. You know, we talked last week how we're the church of all nations, right? One of these, we might even come up with that name one day. I don't know. We're this North Hills Church of America. We're the North Hills Church of Indonesia. We're the North Hills Church of the Philippines. We're the North Hills Church of Mexico and Argentina. Sorry, Gabby, I didn't mean to put those two together, but it's, you know, just kind of going around the globe. We're the North Hills Church of all peoples, of all races, of all languages, right? So if you're an immigrant and you're trying to figure it out in this culture, maybe you're being overwhelmed. Maybe you're all torn up today with all kinds of emotions and anxiety. Maybe you've gone through a divorce, or you're about to go through a divorce. Maybe you're experiencing a loved one who's going through horrible things physically. I don't know what it is that you're going through. Maybe the pressure at work. And you can't... You just can't keep it up. You're not making enough, and you're spending too much. So stop trying to do it all on your own. Turn to God. Let him fight for you. Thank him and praise him for what he's doing. And no matter what happens, find the beauty and the good and the bounty in the middle of chaos and trouble. Because in the end, what? God wins, right? In the end, why don't you say it? God wins. In the end, God wins. You guys need to say it with conviction. I'm not hearing the conviction here. In the end, God wins. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Can we say that to God today? See, our problem is we don't believe it. It's like, I know he wins, but I got to do it right now myself. No. Isaiah 35:10, this is our last verse. We sing a song from time to time built on these words. It's a verse in the Bible that actually shows up in two different places exactly the same. Isaiah 35:10 and then Isaiah 51:11. Those that the Lord has rescued will return. They will enter Zion with singing. Everlasting joy will crown their heads. Gladness and joy will overtake them, and sorrow and sighing will flee away. Those that the Lord has rescued will return. God hasn't abandoned you, my friends. He's not busy somewhere else. He's not waiting for you to straighten your life out. He just wants you to be looking to him, open to him. To close today, I'm going to ask Chris to come up and lead us in a time of prayer. And I want you to think, when we were singing that song, you know, a praise to God, and as we pray, I want you to take whatever that battle is that you're facing, and I want you to put it in the context of what Chris is going to pray for you and for me. And I want you to put the song in that context, that we're praising God, thanking him for already giving us victory.
He's really said a lot today, and I believe that God has spoken. I don't know, you know, if you're, I just feel impressed. I don't know why, but I don't know if there's any particular individuals that want to come down front. Not that, you know, the Holy Spirit's only right here and there's none over there. But if you just want to come down as a family, just to gather together in a close corner, in a close circle. Because as the pastor said, and I, you know, even this morning I heard even more news, just so much going on right here in this room. And God cares. And as we said before, God wins. Does anybody still believe that from a few seconds ago? So if you believe that and you want to pray together right now, don't be shy. We're family. If you want to come down right now just to pray with me, I'm gonna pray, but we're going to pray also within our hearts as a family. We're going to stand up, you know, we're going to stand up against the devil. We're going to stand up against this whole thing of that I got to do it. I've got to change it. I've got to make it happen. And we're going to stay right now in victory that Christ already stated that it's finished, that it's won. So many situations going on, sicknesses, evictions, or whatever the case may be, divorces, pain. God cares.
Amen.
God cares. And he hears your heart. So today we're going to give it to him. Let's all bow our heads together. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for this word that you gave Terry today. Oh, how we need to hear it. That's not by our strength, but in our weakness, your strength is made perfect. Oh, hallelujah. And we know that no matter where we are in life, no matter the confusion, no matter how empty we feel right now, we know that we are filled by your Spirit. You said the Holy Spirit is almost like the wind. You can kind of feel it. You don't know where it's coming from or where it's going, but you know it's there. You see the actions of God. Right now, just like Terry said before, right now, God, first of all, we want to just step out in faith and just say thank you right now. We don't know how you're going to do it. We don't know how everything's going to be fixed. We don't know where it's going to come from. We don't know where the peace is going to come from. But at the end of the day, we're standing here, we're sitting here, we're bowing our heads, and we're saying right now, thank you. Thank you for this victory.
Amen. Thank you.
Thank you for this victory. We don't say it out of emotionalism. We say it out of the fact that in the Bible, you say that all things work together. You see, all things work together for those who love him. So today we stand on that promise right now. And we no longer will subscribe to what the world tells us, that we've got to make it work, that we are the ones who get it. It's our fault if it doesn't work. No, we at this point place it in your hands. And we say, Father, Abba Father, help us, God, to be more like the children, where we totally depend on you. We're not depending on ourselves, but on you. Give us that strength to do that. I don't know what else is going on in this room, God, but you know. And that's just so amazing to me. You know, you look beyond all the things that we see, the smiles, the hugs, the happiness. You see the hurt. You see the pain. You see some people have not slept last night because they've been up all night crying. You see all of that. And God, right now, I ask that you whisper in their ear right now that you are here. That you are here and you care. In closing, God, we just want to once again say thank you. Does anybody else want to say thank you? Just say thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you in faith. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
We love you, God.
Thank you.
In Jesus' name, amen.